Thanks for joining me for this week's online message from Kenmore Community Church. I'm Pastor Mark Rogers. Today is the first Sunday of the month, and here at Kenmore we celebrate communion together on the first Sunday of the month, so I want to encourage you to set aside some communion elements here before we begin, so that at the end of my message you can join me in the celebration of the Lord's Supper. Now, those elements can be a little glass of fruit juice and a piece of bread, or a cracker, or a little glass of wine and bread or a cracker. But if you set them aside now, you'll have them ready when we get to that point at the end of my message. Also want to encourage you to have your Bible nearby. We are studying the Gospel of John, and today we're going to be studying more in John chapter 1. We'll be looking at verses 35 through 51. Of John's Gospel. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we are blessed once again to be able to gather together and to study your word. And Lord, we thank you for your word, and we thank you for our salvation in Christ, and we thank you for the perfection of your character, that you are perfectly loving and perfectly holy and perfectly righteous and just, and you are perfect in all of your perfections, Lord, and we praise you and glorify and honor you for that. Father, we are each one of us coming before you today with various concerns on our hearts and minds, and frankly, we need your help. We need your presence in our lives, and we thank you for your presence in our lives through your Holy Spirit, and pray for wisdom, guidance, and direction with the issues and problems we are each dealing with. Those that need your healing touch, I pray that as the great physician, you might bring healing to their bodies and strengthen them. Give them your sustaining grace. For those, Lord, that are troubled today, anxious, fearful, I pray for your peace to guard their hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. For those, Lord, that have some kind of material need, we pray for your provision in their lives. We know that you are Jehovah Jireh, the God who provides. And Father, we do pray here at Kenmore for our families of the week. We pray for Ellie Mae Burke, for Josh Carter, for Alice Christensen, and for Luke from our youth group. We ask, Father, that these folks would, that you would bless these folks, that you'd encourage these folks, that they might continue to grow and mature in their relationship with you, that they would sense your presence with them this week, and that you would just encourage them to become more and more like Jesus in their thoughts, attitudes, and actions. That's a prayer we pray for all of us, Lord. We pray that by your Spirit you would continue to transform us and empower us for the ministry you have for us. I pray, Lord, this week you would give us opportunity to share the good news of Jesus with someone in our family, in our friendships, in our neighborhood, maybe a coworker. But please open that door of opportunity for us, and then help us to have the courage to step through it. We also want to pray for our mission focus today, which is CareNet Pregnancy Centers. We thank you for the work that they do in helping women with unexpected pregnancies to choose life for their babies, and then to provide resources to help them with that choice and that decision. And so we thank you for CareNet. Pray that you would provide the financial resources they need, the volunteer resources they need, and we pray for their clients, Father, that you would bless and encourage these women that are pregnant or that have recently delivered their babies. We pray for the health and well-being of them, and ultimately for the spiritual well-being of both mother and child. And today, Lord, again, as we turn to studying your word, we pray that you would help us to understand it and see how it applies to our life today. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. We are continuing our study in the Gospel of John today. And again, we're going to be looking at John chapter 1, verses 35 to 51. You may remember, hopefully you remember by now, that the purpose for John's Gospel, he tells us in chapter 20, verse 30 and 31, and that is that we would believe that Jesus is the Son of God, the Messiah, and that by believing we would have life in his name. And so in these verses that we encounter now, today in chapter 1, we see Jesus extending that invitation to life to his first disciples, and also to all of those who would read these scriptures, all of those who would study about Jesus and wonder about him. That invitation to life is extended to everybody who would want to come to Jesus. So if you have your scripture in front of you, follow along as I read now, beginning in John chapter 1, verse 35, ending at the end of the chapter. The next day, John was there again with two of his disciples. When he saw Jesus passing by, he said, "Look, the Lamb of God." When the two disciples heard him say this, they followed Jesus. Turning around, Jesus saw them following and asked, "What do you want?" They said, "Rabbi," which means teacher, "where are you staying?" "Come," he replied, "and you will see." So they went and saw where he was staying, and they spent that day with him. It was about 4 in the afternoon. Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, was one of the two who heard what John had said and who had followed Jesus. The first thing Andrew did was to find his brother Simon and tell him, "We have found the Christ." That is, "We have found the Messiah," that is, the Christ, and he brought him to Jesus. Jesus looked at him and said, "You are Simon, son of John. You will be called Cephas," which when translated means Peter. The next day, Jesus decided to leave for Galilee. Finding Philip, he said to him, "Follow me." Philip, like Andrew and Peter, was from the town of Bethsaida. Philip found Nathanael and told him, "We have found the one Moses wrote about in the law, and about whom the prophets also wrote, Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph." "Nazareth, can anything good come from there?" Nathanael asked. "Come and see," said Philip. When Jesus saw Nathanael approaching, he said to him, "Here truly is an Israelite in whom there is no deceit." "How do you know me?" Nathanael asked. Jesus answered, "I saw you while you were still under the fig tree before Philip called you." Then Nathanael declared, "Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel." Jesus said, "You believe because I told you I saw you under the fig tree. You will see even greater things than that." He then added, "Very truly I tell you, you will see heaven open and the angels of God ascending and descending on the Son of Man." Well, as I mentioned in this passage, the way I've outlined it, the way I see it, this is really an invitation to life on the part of Jesus. He says a number of things here. "Come and see." He says, "Follow me." And not explicitly, but it's implied, he said, "Bring your friends, tell others about me." And then he says, essentially at the end there, "You ain't seen nothing yet. You're going to see even greater things than these." So let's talk about these invitations to life that come from Jesus. First, we see here, beginning in verse 35, that the next day, John the Baptist pointed Jesus out again to two of his disciples. He says, "Look, the Lamb of God." He points Jesus out to two of his disciples. Now, one we know is named Andrew, and the other is unnamed, but most biblical scholars believe it was John, the author of the Gospel, who was the other unnamed disciple. Andrew and John had become disciples of John the Baptist, and we know they had been fishermen in Galilee, but were likely intrigued by the Baptist's call to repent and prepare for the kingdom of God. But John the Baptist kept referring to somebody who was greater than him, who was before him, but now after him, and who was going to come now. And so this is the second time that John the Baptist had referred to Jesus as the Lamb of God. Now, this is a title which would make a connection between Jesus and the sacrifices in the law of Moses. Jesus, by his sacrifice, his death on the cross, would fulfill the symbolism of the Old Testament sacrifices, where an animal was slaughtered and the blood was collected and spread on the altar and over the Ark of the Covenant to make atonement for the sins of the people. Well, Jesus would be that ultimate final sacrifice, that Lamb of God, who would once and for all make atonement for the sins of the people. Andrew and John were intrigued by John the Baptist's statement that he keeps referring to Jesus as the Lamb of God, and so they decide to follow Jesus. And Jesus saw them following, and he turns around and says, "What do you want?" And Andrew and John reply, "Where are you staying?" knowing where Jesus was staying would enable them to seek him out and in private, perhaps, have more time to talk with him than a roadside encounter would allow. Jesus simply responds, "Come and you will see. Come and you will see." Jesus understood that they wanted more than information, and so he offers them relationship. Come with me. Be with me. Find out about me. It's a marvelous invitation. Andrew and John spent the rest of the day with Jesus, likely asking all of their theological questions. Wouldn't that be great? There are times I would love to sit at the feet of Jesus and just ask him all my theological questions, and maybe you're like that as well. During their time with Jesus, their spiritual eyes were opened, and they realized that Jesus was truly the Messiah. Now, Jesus extends this same invitation to come and see to everyone today. In Matthew 11, 28 through 30, Jesus says these words, "Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light." If you want to know the truth about Jesus, he says, come and see. Come read my word. Come fellowship with my people in the church and see what I'm all about. Come and see. Once we know about him and are convinced that he is the Son of God, who has come to save us from our sins and show us how to live an abundant life, he invites us further along the path to knowing him, and he says, follow me. In verse 43, the next day, Jesus decides to head back to Galilee, and along the way, he encounters Philip. And finding Philip, he said to him, follow me. Now, rabbis used this phrase, follow me, to invite disciples to learn from them. And Jewish boys received religious instruction from a very young age, and those that were that excelled in it were encouraged to seek out a rabbi that they could follow when they became a young adult. And so there was a rather rigorous process where they would find a rabbi that they would like to follow, and they would say, "Rabbi, can I follow you?" And they would present their case for why they should be chosen to be a disciple of a particular rabbi. And that rabbi would evaluate their character and evaluate their education. And if he so decided that they would make a good disciple, he would extend the invitation, follow me. Well, Jesus deviates from this process slightly in that he doesn't necessarily wait for the potential disciples to ask if they can follow him, but instead he calls people directly to follow him. Now, what does it mean to follow Jesus? There's a key verse or passage in Luke chapter 14 that I think lays out pretty clearly what it means to follow Jesus. And I've boiled it down to essentially two points. Count the cost and put Christ first. Jesus knew that those who would follow him would pay a high price. So in Luke 14, 28 to 33, he uses a word picture to encourage us to count the cost. He said, "Suppose one of you wants to build a tower. Won't you first sit down and estimate the cost to see if you have enough money to complete it? For if you lay the foundation and are not able to finish it, everyone who sees it will ridicule you, saying, 'This person began to build and wasn't able to finish.' Or suppose a king is about to go to war against another king. Won't he first sit down and consider whether he is able with 10,000 men to oppose the one coming against him with 20,000? If he's not able, he will send a delegation while the other's still a long way off and will ask for terms of peace. In the same way, those of you who do not give up everything you have cannot be my disciples." So Jesus is saying, if you want to follow me, you got to count the cost. Are you willing? What is the cost? To give up everything, basically to put Christ first in everything in your life. And he makes that point in Luke 9, 23 and 24, as well as in Luke 14, 26 and 27. Luke 9 says this, "Then he said to them all, 'Whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves and take up their cross daily and follow me. For whoever wants to save their life will lose it, but whoever loses their life for me will save it. And in Luke 14, 26 and 27, he says, if anyone comes to me and does not hate father and mother, wife and children, brothers and sisters, even their own life, such a person cannot be my disciple. And whoever does not carry their cross and follow me cannot be my disciple. Jesus laid down the gauntlet for being a disciple. If you follow me, you have to deny yourself, pick up your cross daily, and follow my leading. Most people have no clue about the weight or meaning behind those words. Denying yourself is much more than telling yourself no. It's trading your life, your plans, your aspirations for what God's plans are. It's saying, not my will, but your will be done, Lord. It's putting Christ first in all areas of your life. Christianity cannot be an add-on to your life to make sure you get to heaven. It has to be the foundation upon which you build everything else. Your relationship to Christ must be the most important relationship in your life. Salvation is a gift, but discipleship costs you everything. Picking up your cross daily means that you have crucified your old life. That's what it says in Galatians 2:21. And now your life is in Jesus. You not only identify with Jesus, but taking up your cross symbolizing, you know, you're sacrificing your own will and your own desires in order to follow the will and the desires of Jesus. So sacrifice becomes the dominant feature of your nature. Those words may sound difficult, but Jesus knew that if people aren't fully committed, they will wilt and fade away at the first sign of trouble. To be a disciple means to be deeply rooted in the Word of God and committed to becoming like Jesus in your thoughts, in your attitudes, and your actions through the empowerment of the Holy Spirit. In exchange, Jesus promises abundant life now and eternal life hereafter. The benefits of following Jesus always outweigh the costs. But this is what it means to follow Jesus, to count the cost. And what's the cost? I basically surrender to the reign and rule of Christ in my life. I acknowledge him as Lord, and I am his follower. I am dedicated to serving him from that point forward. And so we need to ask ourselves, in response to the text in this passage, have we committed to following Jesus? Jesus said to Philip, follow me. Many of us have put our faith and trust in Jesus, and we've responded to that call to follow him and to come and see who he is. But I fear many of us are still living in a situation where we're trying to keep one foot in the kingdom of God and one foot in the kingdom of this world, not yet fully surrendered to the reign and rule of Christ in our life. So I'd ask you to pray that the Holy Spirit might speak to your heart today and to reveal to you, is that the case? Have you truly submitted to the reign and rule of Jesus Christ? Are you truly following him? Now, once we've followed Jesus in response to his invitation to life, then he tells us basically to go and tell our friends. And while it's not explicitly in this text, it is in other texts where he says, go and make disciples of all nations. But here we see from the actions of Andrew and from the actions of Philip that this is something that Jesus must have encouraged them to do. Because Andrew went and found his brother Simon and told Simon, hey, we have found the Messiah. And it's the first thing that he did after spending time with Jesus was to go and to tell his brother Simon about Jesus. Philip, we read, went and found his friend Nathanael. And he told Nathanael about Jesus and that they had found the Messiah, and it's Jesus of Nazareth. And Nathanael's first response was, can anything good come from Nazareth? Why would he say that? Well, Nazareth at the time was just a very small village, and so could somebody as important of them as the Messiah come from Nazareth? But anyway, Philip says, come and see. He repeats the words of Jesus, come and see, come find out for yourself. So Nathanael comes along with Philip to meet up with Jesus, and when he's arriving on the scene, Jesus looks at Nathanael and says, now here truly is a Jewish man in whom there is no deceit, in whom there is no guile. And Nathanael is somewhat amazed at this. How does Jesus know anything about me? And Jesus says, well, I saw you while you were under the fig tree. And this reveals Jesus' supernatural knowledge, or his omniscience. And in rabbinic literature, sitting in the shade under a fig tree is often associated with a place of worship or meditation and prayer. And that may have been what Nathanael was doing, but we can't say for sure. The emphasis here is on Jesus' supernatural knowledge of where Nathanael was. And that display of supernatural knowledge and revelation to Nathanael, when Jesus says, I saw you sitting under the fig tree, was enough for Nathanael, combined with Philip's testimony that Jesus was the Christ, so that Philip cries out, Rabbi, you are the Son of God, you are the King of Israel. Clearly, Nathanael was acknowledging Jesus as the Messiah, the promised one to whom the scriptures had borne witness. So, again, as we think about this text and how we ought to respond to it, these folks who learned about Jesus, Andrew and Philip, first thing they did was think of somebody they needed to tell, to share this good news with. Andrew tells his brother Peter, imagine what the world would be like, what the Christian world would be like if Andrew never went and told Simon. Simon became the leader of the apostles, the disciples, after Jesus was crucified, died, and ascended back to heaven. He became the early leader of the church there in Jerusalem, and we have his writings and so forth. But just think what would have happened if Andrew had not told Peter. And Nathanael learned from Philip. Philip went and told Nathanael. So who are you sharing the gospel of Christ with on a regular basis? I would encourage every one of us to have a list of people whom we know that don't know Jesus yet, that we are praying for on a regular basis, and that we're praying for opportunities from God to share the good news with them. We're actively seeking, intentionally seeking, to strengthen our relationships with these people so that we can share the good news of Jesus Christ with them. So think even right now of one, two, or three, or four people whom you know that are family members or friends or neighbors or co-workers that you can pray for on a regular basis, and pray for the opportunity to share the good news of Jesus Christ with, and intentionally continue to strengthen and build your relationship with those folks. Come and see, follow me, invite your friends. And then we hear Jesus saying here at the end, essentially, you ain't seen nothing yet. Nathanael trusted in Jesus after Jesus demonstrated his supernatural knowledge. Jesus responds, as I said, by essentially saying, you ain't seen nothing yet. You'll see even greater things than that supernatural knowledge that I had. Now, presumably, Jesus was talking about the miracles, the signs that he would perform that would demonstrate he was truly the Son of God. In the Gospel of John, we're going to see that he turns water into wine at a wedding. We're going to see that he walks on water. We're going to see that he heals a sick person. And there are a number of other signs that John shares with us that point to Jesus as the Messiah. So we can assume that's what Jesus was talking about when he said you're going to see even greater things than these. But then he goes on to say, very truly I tell you, you will see heaven open and the angels of God ascending and descending on the Son of Man. What on earth is Jesus talking about there? Well, some of you who know your Bible pretty well will realize that this imagery is drawn from Jacob's vision of the ladder or the stairway to heaven in Genesis 28. Let me just read Genesis 28, 10 through 12, that mentions Jacob's ladder. Jacob left Beersheba and set out for Haran. When he reached a certain place, he stopped for the night because the sun had set. Taking one of the stones there, he put it under his head and lay down to sleep. He had a dream in which he saw a stairway, a ladder resting on the earth with its top reaching to heaven, and the angels of God were ascending and descending on it. It's in this passage that God reveals himself to Jacob and reaffirms the covenant that he made with Abraham, promising Jacob, whose name will later be changed to Israel, that his offspring will be many and that the promised land will one day belong to his descendants. In this vision, Jacob sees something similar to a ladder or a stairway, which signifies a connection between God and humans. And on this ladder, on this stairway, there are angels ascending and descending from heaven to earth and resting on Jacob. In this instance, it was God who provided the means necessary to link himself to human beings, as compared to, you might remember, the story of the Tower of Babel, where human beings decided to take it upon themselves to try to build a tower to heaven, to reach the heavens and be like God or connect with God. Well, here, you know, we see God doesn't need our help to make this connection between himself and human beings. He's fully capable of doing it by himself. And here in John 1:51, Jesus reveals himself as the mediator who came to earth and became the ladder or the stairway for us to reconnect that relationship with God that had been severed on account of our sin. Romans 5:1-2 says, "Therefore, since we have been justified through faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have gained access by faith into this grace in which we now stand." According to the Bible, then, Jesus was our ideal Jacob's ladder, who came to earth from the line of Jacob through the provision of God and redeemed us so that we may have life in heaven for eternity. What the disciples are promised then in verse 51 is the heaven-sent confirmation that the one they have acknowledged as the Messiah has been appointed by God. You see, every Jewish person honored Jacob, or Israel as his name was changed to, as the father of the 12 tribes. Now everyone must recognize that this same God has appointed Jesus as his Messiah. Jesus is the new Israel. Jesus calls himself in this verse the Son of Man, which is a messianic title coming from the book of Daniel. Jesus is saying here again, you ain't seen nothing yet. It's an invitation to life. Life as a Christ follower is an amazing adventure as we have the opportunity to help people meet, know, and follow Jesus in response to the work of the Holy Spirit in their lives. God is in the business of taking lives that are broken, confused, defeated, worn out, useless, and making something beautiful out of them. These are the greater things that Jesus was talking about, and the greater things that Christ followers can look forward to in our day. Our job is to share the good news of life in Jesus Christ and share his invitation to life. Come and see. Follow me. Invite your friends. And you ain't seen nothing yet. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word here in John chapter 1 and how we see Jesus beginning to extend this invitation to life, abundant life and eternal life, to his first disciples. And then that invitation was meant to be extended by them to everyone. And so, Father, we thank you for this invitation to life. Thank you that we can, even in our day, come and see. We can learn about Jesus. We can read about him in your word, and we can interact with his people in the church, and we can see what Jesus is like and learn who he is, and then we can respond to his call to follow me. And when we have responded to that call, then we can invite our friends too and share the good news with them and recognize that it's a wonderful adventure that we're on with you, that we're going to see great things happening, great miracles taking place in the lives of people as they put their faith and trust in Jesus and are redeemed from the kingdom of darkness and brought into the kingdom of light. And so we thank you, Lord, for this invitation to life. And if there's anybody listening today who's never put their faith and trust in you, I pray they would respond to your invitation to life today, that they would recognize you as the Son of God, the Savior of the world, who died on the cross to pay the penalty for their sins, Those of us who've already made that decision, help us, Lord, to realize what a serious thing it is to follow you and to submit to your reign and rule in our lives. And we pray for opportunities to share this good news of Jesus with our family, with our friends, with our neighbors, with our co-workers. And today, Lord, as we celebrate the Lord's Supper together, we just want to take a moment to prepare our hearts and minds to do that. And Lord, we are so grateful again for our salvation in Christ. We thank you for your forgiveness for sin. And we do confess our sin before you today and ask, Lord, that you would continue to transform our lives. We confess our sins of thought and attitude and speech and sin of relationship where we haven't treated people as we should, and sins of omission where we have not done the things you've asked us to do, and sins of commission where we've gone ahead and done things you've told us not to do. And ultimately, sin boils down to our own self-centeredness, Lord. So forgive us for these things and continue to transform us, Lord. We want to be more and more like Jesus. We thank you for the bread and the cup and how they remind us, Jesus, of your sacrifice on our behalf, and how by partaking of them we proclaim your death until you come, and we proclaim our faith and trust in the life that you give to us, the abundant life and the eternal life that is ours because of your sacrifice. So we ask your blessing on the bread and the cup today in Jesus' name. Amen. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink of it, in remembrance of me." Let's partake together. I pray you have a great week. And again, I encourage you to be praying for the people you know who have yet to put their faith and trust in Christ, and seek to be intentional about building your relationships with them so that you might have opportunity to share this invitation to life from Jesus with them. Let's receive the benediction. Now may the love of God, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. In Jesus' name, amen.